Welcome to the module on logic. We will be going down the rabbit hole, learning some logic with Alice from Alice in Wonderland and a host of assorted monsters. There are various pedagogical reasons for this. First of all, it's that people tend to study logic and it doesn't seem very interesting to them. Let me reassure you, when I first took logic, I dropped that class and I was barely scraping by with a C. Barely, if that. Came back a year later and I retook the course and I loved it and I ended up specializing in formal logic. I enjoyed it so much. And so this particular module is an attempt to show you what all the fuss is about, why people like logic so much, why it's so important to study it, and to reach those of you like me who just frankly weren't aware why it would be important to study logic or what it would mean or what it was like. So I hope you enjoy this course. It's a condensation of my logic course in a way. We can't cover as much ground, but I do hope that you enjoy it. So, quick overview here. There are basically five parts to this module. The argument fallacies will be their own thing, so don't worry about those. We will be studying why someone would approach logic, why someone would study it. Remember, this is an important thing to do. You should always ask about the relevance of what you're doing. I think if I understood more properly why people studied logic, then I would have been more enthusiastic about it. Maybe, or maybe it was maturity, or I don't know. Secondly, we'll talk about parts of arguments. Logic is really the study of arguments. And there's a tendency to think that one person's opinion is as good as another's, but in point of fact, one opinion may be superior to another in the respect that it's more well argued or has better argumentative evidence for it. In that case, that would be a better position. Then we'll talk about kinds of arguments. There are really technically two kinds of arguments, deductive arguments and inductive arguments. Don't worry, you don't need to know the difference yet. But I've included abductive arguments in there, even though abduction is more about trying to explain something, giving the best explanation for something. It is a form of reasoning, and so it's appropriately put under the logic module. Next, we'll look at the features of arguments. So why would you prefer one argument over another? Well, it turns out some arguments are better than others because they have certain structural features, features that exist between the premises and the conclusions. And this is how people can objectively demonstrate to one another, for instance, in a court of law, why their position is superior because they've presented an argument that is valid and sound, with regard to interpretation of the Constitution or something like that. And then lastly is argument fallacies. That will be its own video and its own presentation. So let's get crack-a-lackin'. First thing to point out, what is logic? We often say things like, you're not being logical, or that's not very logical. And actually, what we mean by logic is something very specific. We mean logic is the study of argumentation. It's the study of arguments, the study of the relationship between premises and conclusions. I would look for that one on the exam. That would be a good question to ask you. So next up, number one, why study logic? Why do all of this, right? It seems like it's an awful lot of work. Why do you have to sit there in front of this video and listen to me yap about it? Well, there's a great tradition that extends far, far back in Western philosophy that we should put reason in charge of our souls. And when we make reason the boss, the head honcho or honcha, when reason is running things, that is a harmonious soul. That is a soul that is well ordered. It is in its proper place, right? All the parts are in their proper place. This helps us avoid things like ignorance, right? It helps us avoid things like blind passion. Certainly it's great to be extemporaneous in your life, to make split decisions and go do big things, but it's also important to think about the decisions that you make and what consequences flow from them. The better we can do that, the better we can make better decisions. So the idea is you want to use reason to awaken your mind, to awaken your deliberative, rational mind. Put reason in charge and stop sleepwalking through life like a zombie. And I think what you'll notice is even with the small amount of logic that we discuss, the fallacies, the validity, soundness, strength, cogency, all that stuff, even with that small amount, you'll begin to notice when you're speaking to somebody and they make some sort of a claim or an argument and you say to yourself, wow, that's a terrible argument. There's no relationship between what you want to establish and the reasons you've given for that thing. So the idea is you're awakening a part of yourself. You put reason in charge. Second reason why we study logic, logic is self-correcting. Look, if you make a mistake in logic, you can figure out your mistake. You can go back and say, now, where is this error? You unfortunately cannot do that with forms of ignorance. If somebody is ignorant, there will be no remedy to that until you apply logic, right? You need to think things through properly. And so we like logic because it's self-correcting. It's self-correcting. Prejudice and ignorance do not correct themselves, but logic will. Another reason why we study logic, so this is number three, logic, like mathematics, is a really strong form of evidence because it's always and everywhere true. Look, if I tell you that it's true that if I'm in San Francisco, then I'm in California, and it's true that I'm in San Francisco, then you would know absolutely beyond a shadow of a doubt that I'm in California. If those first two sentences were true, that it's true that if I'm in San Francisco, then I'm in California, and it's true that I'm in San Francisco, you have to conclude that I'm in California. I mean, how do you think we do it, right? Mathematics? I mean, it's because logic is always going to be true, that if someone's argument or position relies on bad logic, we have to abandon it because it would be violating certain laws. So think about it this way. I say, you know, when is 2 + 2 = 4 true? And you'd say, always. And I'd say, yeah. And so that makes it a really good, powerful form of evidence for us, right? That's why physicists can tell us the speed at which something will fall to the ground, even calculating wind resistance. Well, because that's mathematics. And so we have this example I just reviewed on the screen. Look, if you know that number one is true, if clean is in Long Beach, then clean is in California, if you know that sentence is true, and if you know number two, clean is in Long Beach, is true, then you would absolutely have to conclude that clean is in California. There's just no universe in which one and two can be true and three can be false. It's the way reality works. We have a tendency sometimes for people to say, well, it's true for you, but it's not true for me, and we have our own universe. Yeah, you go ahead and think that and you'll be wrong, right? Because logic helps us to establish and support our positions. That, you know, reality does have some objective features to it, and logic helps us lock onto those and use them to guide our thought. All right. In that way, the laws of logic are how we understand reality. If the laws of logic weren't true, look, if it was not the case that if one is true and two is true, three follows, then we just wouldn't even know how to understand reality. Things would not make any sense to us. And so in that way, logic can be understood as sharing a structure with reality. Sometimes people say this with mathematics, right? That mathematics is isomorphic with reality. It shares a shape. There's one shape there. You talk to a physicist and they'll tell you, look, it's all numbers at the bottom, Jack. It's just the way it is when you get deep down there. And that's true of logic also, that logic and reality share a kind of structure. Now, what's kind of fun about this is if you've ever heard of Alice in Wonderland, it's a book. It was actually produced by Walt Disney as a movie. There are earlier versions of it. There's one I'm thinking of. I think it's from 1913, but I could be totally wrong. In fact, I'm sure I am. Lewis Carroll was a mathematician, and he loved to show the structure that reality and logic kind of share, mathematics and in particular, shares with reality within the context of the Alice in Wonderland story itself. And so for this point, I just wanted to bring up to you this killer book, Alice's Adventures in Wonderland. I got this book from my colleague and office mate, Professor Lawrence, and it's an absolute killer, and I just love it. It's written by David Day. It's just an excellent, excellent book. It talks about all these wonderful references in this story. There's a lot more going on there than you'd think. Also, if you're into this sort of stuff, Martin Gardner has written a nice annotated Alice, Lewis and Carroll. This is the 150th anniversary edition, but it's also a good book. But let's just get down to to the brass tacks here. In the beginning of the story of Alice in Wonderland, Alice is bored and she's considering making a daisy chain. This is something that people used to do, sort of fill the time. And what he's doing is, Lewis Carroll is combining a 13th century math problem about rabbits and Fibonacci sequences with the start of this story. Now, I understand you may go, oh, come on, you know, this was... No, he actually really does this. He had a copy of this book, and we know that this is what he meant to do. So this is a fun example. It's to show you that reality and logic can, and reality and mathematics can share a structure, and so it's kind of worthwhile to study it. So, okay. So Alice, this is from the text, is considering in her own mind whether the pleasure of making a daisy chain would be worth the trouble. So daisies are a flower, and these flowers bloom according to Fibonacci sequences. Then the next thing that happens is Alice sees a rabbit go down this rabbit hole, right? And as she's falling, she thinks to herself, my gosh, I've been falling for so long. It seems like I've sort of been falling forever, right? Well, we know that he had this book, and it's a sort of famous math problem that people struggled to solve. It states, beginning with a single pair of rabbits, if every month each productive pair bears a new pair, which becomes productive when they are 1 month old, how many pairs of rabbits will there be after a year? So the idea is, right, you have two rabbits, okay, and then after 1 month, they have a new pair, right, two new ones, which becomes productive when they're 1 month old. And then this goes on and on and on like that. How many pairs of rabbits will be productive after a year? This is significant when we write these numbers as decimal fractions, because this becomes what is known as the golden ratio. And when you graph them a certain way, these two values approach one another but never quite get there. And when you graph them, it looks like, wait for it, an infinite rabbit hole. I know this sounds strange, but it's kind of a joke, right? He thinks it's pretty funny. Ha ha ha. I'm going to mention this math problem, this strange relationship that exists with this very famous math problem and something known as the golden ratio. Now you may say, gosh, who cares, right? Okay, so you've told me that this guy put this obscure reference into this work. What does it really matter? What does this have to do with what we're studying? Well, this particular golden ratio, which he alludes to in the beginning of this story, occurs throughout nature. It's called the golden ratio. In fact, one of my students' husbands graduated. I didn't have him as a student. He didn't need to take any philosophy. But on the top of his hat, he actually had a graph of the golden ratio. But you can see here, within this shell, the way that it grows is in conformance with the golden ratio. And you can see this succulent there does the same thing. Pine cones do this. It's pretty far out. Another succulent. What? Okay. They're easy to grow. We can even see in something like the Parthenon here, right? The Greeks were aware of this golden ratio, and they composed buildings and so forth in accordance with it. The Greeks were very into mathematics, particularly Plato thought math was just fantastic. Quick side note, if you're ever reading a Platonic dialogue and Plato brings up math, somebody's about to get whooped, right? Anytime there's a math example in Plato, somebody's about to get curb stomped. Okay, and then you can see neat things here. Here's an example of it in architecture, right? The golden ratio in this stairwell. And there we have it in Botticelli's art. I think that's him. And then we have a tattoo, of course. That ain't me. That's just some random bloat. Okay. You can see it on a small scale with a rose. You can see it in a large scale here with a hurricane. So the idea here is that math shares a certain relationship with reality, and logic does the same thing. And so it's worthwhile to study this because it's part of studying reality and the world in which we live. Okay, we are now on part two, parts of arguments. parts of arguments. Okay, so I'll define a couple of terms here. First thing I wanted to point out is that an argument is not the same as a fight between two persons, right? Between two people. Normally, when I say, oh, I had an argument, right, it means Professor Vitt is sleeping on the couch. Okay, that's what it normally means. But in logic and in philosophy, we mean something much more specific. We don't mean a physical fight or an emotional fight, right? We mean something technical. We say an argument is a group of statements in which the conclusion is claimed to follow from the premises. So what we have are a group of statements, right? And all of these statements sort of support something at the end, which is our conclusion. So the stuff doing the supporting are our premises, and the stuff being supported is our conclusion. And you can see that here in our next slide. Premises are statements offered to support the conclusion, a statement or statements offered to support the conclusion. And the conclusion is the statement that's being supported by the premises. There's one other thing I just want to draw your attention to here, because it'll come in later when we start talking about features of arguments. It's the inference relation or the support relationship. All that I mean is it's the degree to which the premises support the conclusion. And in some cases, the premise is going to be so strong that they'll force the conclusion to be true. That would be like that first example with Clean being in Long Beach. Remember, if Clean is in Long Beach, then Clean is in California. Clean is in Long Beach, therefore Clean is in California. There, that inference relation, the support relation between the premise and the conclusion, is extremely strong. It's 100%. There'll be other kinds of arguments that don't have that same strong relation. Quick side note here, premises and conclusions have got to be statements. And when I say statements, I mean they have to be capable of being true or false. So a thing is a statement if it is capable of being true or false. So in Alice in Wonderland, she's going around and things say, drink me, right? So here are some Alice in Wonderland cookies that say, eat me. Do you think that that statement right there, excuse me, that cookie that says eat me, is that a statement? And I'm asking you at home, you can say yes or no out loud, it's fine either way. You might say, yeah, that's a statement, but I would ask you, well, could that be true or false? So when you see that cookie and it says eat me, would you say, no, I don't think I'll eat you, or would you say false? Well, no, you wouldn't say false, right? Because eat me is a command. It's a request to do something, namely to eat the delicious cookie, right? It is not a statement that is either true or false. It's not a statement that either obtains or does not obtain in the world. Okay, let's try this one. We're all mad. Oh, you probably can't see it because I'm blocking it. So here's a picture of the Cheshire Cat. And underneath it, it says, we're all mad here. And is that a statement? Yeah, look, it's either true or false that we're all crazy here. Maybe we're all nuts, who knows? Presuming you know what you mean by the word nuts or mad, right? Or crazy, some kind of clinical or pathological problem, right? Then that would be either true or false, right? We're either all crazy or we're not all crazy. I'll say, so here's another example, right? Drink me. No, that's not a statement, right? Because it's not true or false. It's a request or command to do something. Drink me. No, it's not true or false, right? It's just a command. It's a request to do something. There's another one here. It says, ouch. This person's obviously getting the smack down there, and it says, ouch. You probably can't see it because I'm in the way, sorry. But a statement like, ouch, if let's suppose we're working in the yard and accidentally, right, we're working near the rabbit hole on our daisies in the yard, and I'm digging away and I accidentally hit the shovel on my foot and I go, ouch, right? Somebody wouldn't say true, right? They wouldn't say that, even though it might sound like I'm saying I am in pain. Right? Those are not actually the equivalent of each other. Ouch is not the same thing as I am in pain. Look, if we were in the yard, same scenario, we're in the yard and I'm digging, we're by the rabbit hole there looking after the daisies, and I'm digging away and I say, I am in pain, but you happen to notice that I never actually hit the shovel on my foot, I'm just trying to play a joke on you or be deceptive or something, you would say false, right? You'd say, you're not in pain. You said you were in pain. You're not in pain. But notice then, if it's the same scenario and I'm pretending, I'm digging away, I don't hit my foot, but I say, ouch, you notice the deception, you would not then say, false, right? You wouldn't say that. It wouldn't make any sense. You'd say, oh, you're fibbing, you're not, right? But you wouldn't say false because ouch is not a statement. It doesn't predicate anything of a subject. It's just an expression. Okay. I'm late. That would be a statement, right? We have a subject, I, and then we're saying of the subject, yeah, this particular predicate belongs to you, this characteristic belongs to you, this property belongs to you, right? Namely, you're late. So we know this happens with the white rabbit, right? This is how the whole thing starts off. He's running towards a hole, and he says, I'm late for a very important date. All right, so now let's take a deep breath and put all of this stuff together. I want to give you some examples of arguments so you know what they look like, you get the feel for what we're doing. And again, if this isn't super familiar, that's okay, because we're all learning this together. This is all something that we're beginning to do together, so I understand completely. All right, premise number one, all people are mortal. Premise two, Socrates is a person. Conclusion thus, Socrates is mortal. So this would be an example of an argument. And notice this would be a pretty strong one, because if one and two were true, then three would have to be true, right? One says all people are mortal, meaning there's a class of things, and in this class of things all share in being mortal, right? They're all sorted by the trait of being mortal. Then premise two says, Socrates is one of the members of that class. He's a person, right? And then premise three says, conclusion three says, well, then because of that, then we know that he's part of that bigger class. He's mortal. So it's not possible for one and two to be true and three to be false. All right. Here's another example. Premise one, Gabe is crazy or Gabe is lying. Those are the only two options, right? We'll find out a little bit later that there are some wrinkles in there. Notice I had to put that qualifier in on premise one. Gabe is crazy or Gabe is lying. Those are the only two options. Gabe is not crazy. Well, then what do I have to know? Then he's lying, right? Just, one is true and two is true. Then the only way we could conclude would be three, assuming one exhausts all the possibilities. Okay, here's a different kind of argument. It might seem kind of strange, but it is still an argument. Premise number one. On Monday, Professor Vitt wore blue. So suppose you come to campus, you see me there, and I'm wearing a blue shirt. Okay. Then premise number two, on Tuesday, Professor Vitt wore blue. Again, you come to campus, you see me wearing this blue shirt. Looks good, right? But it's a blue shirt. He's doing it again. This cat's apparently just got only blue shirts in his wardrobe. Premise three, you see me on Wednesday. It's hump day, right? Professor Vitt, we're halfway through the week. And I go, yeah, how's it going? And you notice I'm wearing blue again. Now, if you were trying to judge what the future would be like on the basis of the past, then if 1, 2, and 3 were true, then you would say, look, probably it's going to be the case that he's going to wear blue on Thursday because that's all he's worn this week, right? So if the future is like the past, if the future is indicated by the past, then what I wore to school on Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday is going to be some indicator of what I wear on Thursday, right? I understand it's kind of a strange example, but it is just to get you thinking in terms of certain arguments proceed from specific instances to the future, right? From observed instances to unobserved instances. All right, here's another one. This is an absolutely super duper uber famous argument in the history of philosophy. Goes way back to a Roman named Cicero. And you can actually find some of these design arguments before Cicero. You can find him in the Greeks. But certainly he's the first one to use a clock, but he actually uses a sundial, which is kind of funny now, right? We think about a sundial, it's sort of hilarious, right? But okay, so here we go. Premise number one, A clock is complex. Premise number two, a clock has a designer. Premise number three, the universe is complex. Conclusion number four, thus the universe also has a designer. Now, you might have heard of this argument before. It's often called the watchmaker. It's a teleological argument for the existence of God. So the idea is that the universe in some way exhibits hallmarks of design that we see, and we can conclude that the universe was designed and infer the existence of God or something like that. This was a very famous, this is a specific form of those kinds of arguments. This is an argument by analogy. There are all different sorts of varieties of these. This particular form of argument, you may find it initially really compelling. It is really compelling initially. It's really, really, it seems to have something to it. But in point of fact, David Hume, a Scottish philosopher, attacks and essentially destroys this version of the argument by analogy, in his Dialogues Concerning Natural Religion. He attacks on a variety of fronts. There are many criticisms. We cover them in Modern Philosophy. And then we also briefly discuss, like, it's not the end of the show, right? People come along and they change the argument in little interesting ways. Probably, I think, the most famous current version of this is a teleological argument by Richard Swinburne. And it's a doozy. It's really fun and interesting. The point here is not to have you come down one way or the other about the design of the universe, right? It's to show you the force that arguments can have. The idea that you could just talk to somebody and try to demonstrate something so profound as the existence or non-existence of God by relating premises and conclusions, you can see, gosh, this has a wide variety of applications. And obviously, as an attorney, I've seen argumentation unfold many dozens, thousands, and thousands of times in a court of law. Okay, here's another example of an argument. I just want to bring this up because I wanted to give you an example of a bad argument and also foreshadow fallacies down in section five. So premise number one, Isabella is stupid. Conclusion, thus I am right. Okay, notice that this is a terrible argument for many reasons. Number one, there's no relationship between Isabella's stupidity or lack thereof and my own being right or wrong on any particular issue. Isabella is just a name I picked, right? It's just a name I picked out of the blue. There's no relationship between the premise and the conclusion. What we'd say is the inference relation there is super weak. It's probably at 0%. But notice that in other arguments, right, the relationship is stronger. Here in this argument, 1 and 2 are pretty strongly force you into 3. But when you look here, I mean, one can be true or false. It has no relationship to somebody being right. Whether or not you're right depends on conditions that are independent of Isabella's, you know, cognitive status. That's the first point. There's no logical relationship between one and two. Now, what's really going on here, if somebody was foolish enough to try and advance this as an argument, this would be a bad argument. What would be happening there would be that somebody would be committing a fallacy, an error in reasoning, a mistake in reasoning. And that's what a fallacy is. It's you're trying to reason properly, but you don't do it right. If you're ever arguing with somebody about something and they insult you and they say, well, you're stupid, what do you know? You can go ahead and say, thank you, I'm going to clean up shop, right? Because they've conceded the point. They have nothing else to argue. They've just been reduced to personal attack, which has nothing to do. There's no logical relevance whatsoever to the conclusion. So that's just an example of a bad argument. Okay. Now, the next thing I wanted to bring up was just a couple of exercises where we identify the premise and the conclusion in passages so that you can see that I'm not just making up arguments. They actually do exist in texts and so forth. Hold on, let me just take a sip here. This is a Trader Joe's Moroccan mint tea. It's pretty good. All right. Identify the premise and the conclusion in this passage. This is taken from Skin Show's Gothic Horror and the Technology of Monsters by Judith Halberstam. Jack Halberstam also played a role. I don't think he's a co-author, though. I think he edited it. I'm not sure. And they're talking about The Nightmare Before Christmas. I don't know if you've ever seen this. If you have, big up. If you haven't, essentially, there's a guy, Jack Skellington, and he runs Halloween. That's like his thing. He runs Halloween Town. So he runs the holiday of Halloween. And he gets tired of it. So he decides, he stumbles in through the woods, and he decides, I've got the book around here. He decides that he's going to go to Christmas, and then he's going to run Christmas this year. So he combines the two holidays. And if you're sitting there going, yeah, we know the story, we get it, I'm sorry you had to sit through that. Okay. Judith Halberstam writes, the transformation of Christmas into Halloween is the gothicization of the sentimental. Presents and toys, foods and decorations are all transformed from cheery icons of goodwill into fanged monsters, death masks, and all manner of skullduggery. Kids are frightened, parents are shocked, Santa Claus is kidnapped, and mayhem ensues. Okay, so first things first, I'm going to show you her conclusion. Her conclusion is that the transformation of Christmas into Halloween is the gothicization. Easy for me to say, huh? Gothicization? That's better, right? I was giving it a soft C in there. I ain't going to go back and edit it. I'm not that perfect in my pronunciation. But that should be a note to you. It's okay when you're reading out loud to mispronounce things. The transformation of Christmas into Halloween is the gothicization of the sentimental. So she's saying, look, this is what I'm trying to prove, right? And then she has all these premises, two of them, right? Where she notes that, you know, presents and toys and foods and decorations go from being sources of goodwill and cheer into the very opposite of that, right? These fanged monsters, remember, little Jane Neiman gets a baby doll of a demon and all that, right? So death masks and all that stuff. So she's giving examples that support her conclusion, right? So presents and toys are turned into fang monsters. Food and decorations are death masks, blah, 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 blah. All kinds of skullduggery. And then she continues, kids are frightened, parents are shocked. This is the opposite of what should be happening for Christmas, right? And so what this is we've gothicized Christmas, right? We've made things more morbid and macabre, and we've given them a different kind of flavor. All right. Next argument here, and if you are a dog person, I'm sorry, and if you're a cat person, I'm sorry, I'm either way. I can go either way. I'm down with animals generally. It's fine. Identify the premise and the conclusion. So I'll read it out loud, and then just in your own head, try to find the conclusion first, and then we'll work through. We'll find the conclusion, and then we'll find the premises. Here we go. Cats can think circles around dogs. My cat regularly used to close and lock the door to the doghouse, trapping our sleeping dog inside. Our cat also used to use the toilet. All right, so what's the conclusion here? Those are premises. All right, let's just break it all out. I can't believe I put that one last. The conclusion is the very first sentence. Cats can think circles around dogs. That's what is trying to be established here. And then we get two reasons that come afterwards. My cat regularly used to close and lock the door to the doghouse, trapping our sleeping dog inside. That's one piece of evidence. And then the second piece of evidence is our cat used to also use the toilet. This is a bad argument. And if you can't quite see it, take a second and think about whether this person has actually established that cats can generally think circles around dogs. Has this person really given enough evidence to show that all cats are smarter than all dogs? Well, no, they're just talking about their cat that used to lock their dog in something, and then that the cat used to also use the toilet. I mean, you know, it's just not very convincing. Maybe you had a super smart cat and a not so smart dog. It's just you have a case of one, and yet there are millions and millions of cats and dogs. So, all right. I took an example from Cleve's book. It's a textbook that we often use for this course. I know that the student plagiarized since I found the exact same sentences on a website and the website was published more than a year before the student wrote the paper. So here is a premise. Let's go to the push. I'm so sorry. The conclusion is, I know that the student plagiarized, right? So the conclusion is, the student plagiarized, okay? The student plagiarized is the conclusion. I'm going to leave that "I know that" off there because it makes it what's called an opaque context. You don't need to know about it. Don't worry. It's just one quick example. Our conclusion is, the student plagiarized since, meaning, hey, this is... going to provide some reasoning here. The student plagiarized. I found the exact same sentences on a website, and also that website was published over a year ago. So both of those things together support the conclusion that the student plagiarized. I'm leaving off the "I know that" because I don't want this to become an explanation. I want it to be an argument. All right. Make the following passages into an argument with premises and conclusions. So we're still working with arguments. We're working with premises and conclusions. I gotta get that. Okay, and in doing these, we're gonna do two passages from Alice in Wonderland. They're both kind of similar. And then we're gonna look at a very famous zombie movie from 1968, Night of the Living Dead. So let's look at the passages. First, we're going to make them into an argument with premises and conclusions. So at one point in Alice in Wonderland, Alice is trying to figure out who she is. And she says, "I'm sure I'm not Gertrude," she said, "for her hair goes in such long ringlets, and mine doesn't go in ringlets at all." So what would this passage look like in terms of premises and conclusions, right? So what is she trying to establish here? She's trying to establish she's not Gertrude. She's sure of that, right? And then she said, "For her hair goes in such long ringlets, and mine doesn't go in ringlets at all." And so here we have the passage on the left. "I'm sure I'm not Gertrude," she said, "for her hair goes in such long ringlets, and mine doesn't go in ringlets at all." And then on the right, we have what it would look like as an argument. "If someone is Gertrude, then her hair goes in long ringlets. My hair does not go in ringlets, thus I am not Gertrude." Now, you might quibble with this, right? In terms of, you know, is one valid or something like that. But this is the argument that's being given. And as long as you can see that there is to be a relationship between thinking that you're not Gertrude and the reasons you would give for that, it's fine, right? It's fine. I understand it seems kind of rinky-dink and bizarre, but it's the way to start thinking about premises and conclusions. And I'm sure I can't be Florence, for I know all sorts of things, and she knows such a very little. Okay, man, harsh on Florence, right? And so here again we have the argument on the left, or the passage on the left, and then what the argument would look like on the right. If someone is Florence, then that person knows such a very little. Two, I know all sorts of things, that is to say, not very little, thus I am not Florence. Okay, so our next example is going to come from Night of the Living Dead, an absolute classic in horror films. We wouldn't have all the zombie stuff we have today if it wasn't for this particular movie. And we're going to look at a dialogue here that takes place in the movie. It's just 4 or 5 minutes long, and we can use it because this movie has no copyright. It's in the public domain. We are going to look at a disagreement that erupts as to what is the safest place to be in the place, the cellar or the upstairs. So here we go.
"Consistent reports from witnesses to the effect that people who acted as though they were in a kind of trance were killing and eating their victims prompted authorities to examine the bodies of some of the victims. Medical authorities in Cumberland have concluded that in all cases, the killers are eating the flesh of the people they murdered. Repeating this latest bulletin just received moments ago from Cumberland, Maryland, civil defense authorities have told newsmen that murder victims show evidence of having been partially devoured by their murderers. Medical examination of victims' bodies shows conclusively that the killers are eating the flesh of the people they kill. And so this incredible story becomes more ghastly with each report. It's difficult to imagine such a thing actually happening, but these are the reports we have been receiving and passing on to you, reports which have been verified as completely as is possible in this confused situation. It is happening, and it would appear that no one is safe from this wave of mass murder."
I'm just suit. We're from town. City.
A radio.
County, Pennsylvania. The Butler County Sheriff has verified that reports of murder victims being partially eaten by their slayers is true. No further details available at this time. However,
how long you guys been down there? I could use some help up here.
That's the cellar. It's the safest place.
You mean you didn't hear the racket we were making up here?
How were we supposed to know what was going on? Could have been those things for all we knew.
That girl was screaming. Sure, you must know what a girl screaming sounds like. Those things don't make any noise. Anybody would know somebody ever needed help.
Look, it's kind of hard to hear what's going on from down there.
We thought we could hear screams, but for all we knew, that could have meant those things were in the house afterward.
And you wouldn't come up and help.
Well, if there were more,
the racket sounded like the place was being ripped apart. How were we supposed to know what was going on?
Now, wait a minute. You just got finished saying you couldn't hear from down there. Now you say it sounded like the place was being ripped apart. It would be nice if you'd get your story straight, man.
All right, now you tell me. I'm not going to take that kind of a chance when we got a safe place. We luck into a safe place, and you're telling us we got to risk our lives just because somebody might need help, huh?
Yeah, something like that.
All right, why don't we settle this,
Mister? We came up. Okay, we're here. Now I suggest we all go back downstairs before any of those things find out we're in here.
They can't get in here.
You got the whole place boarded up?
Yeah, most of it. All but a few spots upstairs. They won't be hard to fix.
You're insane. The cellar's the safest place.
I'm telling you, they can't get in here.
And I'm telling you, those things turned over our car. We were damn lucky to get away at all. Now you tell me those things can't get through this lousy pile of wood?
His wife and kids downstairs. The kids hurt.
Well, I still think we're better off up here.
We could strengthen everything up, Mr. Cooper.
With all of us working, we could fix this place up in no time. We have everything we need up here.
We can take all that stuff downstairs with us. Man, you're really crazy, you know that? You got a million windows up here. All these windows, you're gonna make them strong enough to keep these things out, huh?
I told you, those things don't have any strength. I smashed three of them and pushed another one out the door.
Did you hear me when I told you they turned over our car?
Oh, hell, any good five men can do that.
That's my point. Only there's not going to be five or even 10. There's going to be 20, 30, maybe 100 of those things. And as soon as they know we're here, this place is going to be crawling with them.
Well, if they're that many, they'll probably get us wherever we are.
Look, the cellar. The cellar, there's only one door, right? Just one door, that's all we have to protect. Tom and I fixed it so it locks and boards from the inside. But up here, all these windows, why, we'd never know where they were going to hit us next.
You got a point, Mr. Cooper. But down in the cellar, there's no place to run to. I mean, if they did get in, there'd be no back exit. We'd be done for. We can get out of here if we have to. And we got windows to see what's going on outside. But down there with no windows, if a rescue party did come, we wouldn't even know it.
But the cellar is the strongest place.
The cellar is a death trap.
I don't know, Mr. Cooper. I think he's right. You know how many's out there?
I don't know. Maybe six or seven.
Look, you two can do whatever you like. I'm going back down to the cellar, and you better decide. Because I'm going to board up that door, and I'm not going to unlock it again, no matter what happens.
Now, wait a minute, Mr. Cooper.
No, I'm not going to wait. I've made my decision. Now, you make yours.
Now, wait a minute. Let's think about this. We can make it to the cellar if we have to. And if we do decide to stay down there, we'll need some things from up here. So let's at least consider this a while.
If you box yourself in the cellar and those things get in the house, you've had it. At least up here you have a fighting chance.
All right, so we're going to review this dialogue. I'll try to go as quickly as I can. I will not give you any spoilers as to what happens at the end if you haven't seen that movie, but I encourage you to watch it. It's in the public domain, but it's actually a great film. If I have time, I'll mention a couple of angles on this film that are really interesting that I think make it worthwhile. It's more than just a black and white in the public domain, but we'll get to that in a second. So what I've done in this document is, and you have access to it, I've made some small comments here in the green, and then where appropriate, I've just tried to demonstrate what people are trying to argue in the blue box. And so I'll read some of the blue boxes, but they're there so that you can see, oh, this is what people are trying to say, right? This is how this is supposed to go. I know it's a lot for just 5 minutes of film, but hopefully it shows you that there is a kind of rigor underlying our natural language and our normal discussions. And you can tap into that to help convince people of things. This is such a great scenario because these people are literally arguing for their lives. If they make the wrong decision, it's all over. So, okay, let's start here with the truck driver. A couple of notes here on names. The truck driver is Dwayne. He's the person that you're kind of cheering for in this dialogue. Harry is the guy who wants to be downstairs, right? Harry has kind of got this gruff, antagonistic nature about him. He seems much less sympathetic to me than does Dwayne. They also refer to Harry as Mr. Tinsdale in the screen play, but they call him Mr. Cooper on the set, I guess. I don't know whether that's directorial changes, rewrites, or just the extemporaneous nature of acting. I don't have a clue. But as long as you'll see, there are really just a couple of people who are the moving parts in this dialogue. The main idea is that we have a position, right? Which is the safest place, right? We're going to have Harry arguing that the safest place is going to be the cellar. And we are going to have Dwayne, the truck driver, arguing that it is not the safest place. Okay. The truck driver. So we cut in kind of mid-scene. You just said it was hard to hear down there. Now you say it sounded like the place was being ripped apart. You better get your story straight, right, mister? He actually says, you know, it'd be nice if you got your story straight, man. So what Dwayne does is he captures Mr. Cooper in a prior inconsistent statement. I loved it when this happened in court, right? You can show that somebody is contradicting themselves, and then you have to kind of force them to abandon one of their assumptions, or you show them that their argument is incoherent. And that's what he does right away. So you realize that immediately, right? Dwayne ain't gonna take nothing from this guy, and the stakes are super high. Harry says, all right, now you tell me. I'm not gonna take these kinds of chances when we got a safe place. We lock into a safe place, and you're telling me we gotta risk our lives just because somebody needs help. So I think what Mr. Cooper is trying to do here is a reductio. He's saying, look, you want us to risk our lives? Who would risk their lives for anything at all, right? Nobody wants to risk their life. It's like the most important thing. Nobody would want to do that. But I just love Dwayne's response. He's like, something like that, yeah. In other words, he just doubles down here, right? He shreds it again. He says, look, yeah, I was expecting you to help people. I guess that makes me a big jerk, right? His response just shows the disdain that he has, right? He's got nothing but contempt for Mr. Cooper. Okay, and then Tom is in the middle here. He's kind of like, I don't know, a little bit of a pendulum feature in this dialogue, and he doesn't know who is what. And he says, why don't we settle this? And then Harry shouts over everybody, all right, we came up here. What do you want? You know, we're up here, right? I mean, what do you want? We're up here now. And then, Dwayne points out that the zombies can't get in there. And Tom asks, oh, you got the whole place boarded up? And they start chatting. And then all of a sudden, Harry butts in, right? And he's like, you're insane. The cellar is the safest place in the house. And what I wanted to point out about this is if we put this argument into standard form, and standard form is just a fancy way of saying you've got your premises stated and you've got your conclusion stated. And so you say, you are insane, right? He's saying, you're insane, that's premise one, therefore the cellar is the safest place. Well, that's actually a terrible argument for a couple of reasons. Number one, there's no relationship between one and two, right? One doesn't provide any support for the conclusion, number two. Also, and this is additionally why it's a fallacy, at least in part, it's that a fallacy is being committed here. It's a mistake, right? Your name calling. When somebody starts calling you a name, stupid or arrogant or something like that, okay, they have lost the argument because what you're debating is your conclusions and the reasons you have for the conclusions. And once you veer off that course, you're no longer talking about the same subject matter. And all that you're exposing is how impoverished your own situation is, right? All right, so Harry makes that ad hominem, then Dwayne lashes out. I'm telling you, they can't get in here. So Dwayne is counter-arguing that the upstairs is actually safe because he's boarded it up, right? And the reason for moving to the cellar that it's safe gets anticipated by Dwayne. He goes, look, it's safe up here. I've boarded it up here. And Harry says, and I'm telling you, those things turned over our car, right? And you tell me they can't get through a pile of wood. Now, there's a lot more going on there, but we'll just stick with premises and conclusions. Harry's making this argument. Premise one, the zombies were so strong they turned over our car. Premise two, zombies that strong could get up through the boarded up windows, Conclusion three, thus the cellar is the safest place. So you see, there's a conclusion and then reasons for thinking that conclusion. So Harry's given a reason here. He's saying that the wood won't hold against the zombies. Look, they turned over the car. And if this point is true, it would counter Dwayne's point about the upstairs being safe, right? Look, great that you use the wood, bro. They're throwing cars around. Tom then interjects and adds a critical piece of information, which Mr. Cooper never properly exploits for rational ends, in my opinion. He says, his wife and kids downstairs, the kids pretty tore up. Now, this takes Dwayne by surprise, right? Oh, maybe now he realizes that Mr. Cooper had a reason for not coming upstairs, right? If he had a family, children, somebody who's maybe in ambulatory, they can't move around, then maybe it's excusable that they didn't come up. The truck driver, I love this about this character, right? He stops, but he's still going to argue. He says, look, I get it. You got family. That changes things. Maybe that explains why you're so strung out and, you know, yelling at everybody. But I actually still think I want what's best for you. They want what's best for you. I actually think it's better for you to be upstairs, right? And so he then begins to make these arguments. He says, with all of us working, we could fix this up. So nothing could get in here, right? So he's trying to address Cooper's concerns about how safe the place is. And he said, we can all save it up. We can fix it up. And the upstairs, we've got food, we've got fire, and we've got the radio. So look at this. This is just that argument being supplied. The upstairs has radio, fire, food. The cellar does not have fire, food, or radio. And so the upstairs is the better place, right? Dwayne is just demonstrating that the upstairs has features that the basement doesn't have. The upstairs has radio and fire and all this stuff, and the cellar doesn't have those things. But Harry will not be undone, right? He's not gonna walk away from this one. A little bit of confirmation bias here, right? A little bit of a backfire effect. He says, we can bring all those things downstairs with us. You're crazy. You got a million windows up here, and all these windows, you're going to make all of them, right? Meaning a multitude, a big number of them, strong enough to keep them out. And so Harry makes this argument right here on the right. Everything the upstairs has, the basement can also have. And so our conclusion is that the cellar is still the safest place. So all of those features that the upstairs have, those features can be transferred to the downstairs. You could actually argue this, right? But Dwayne doesn't get into it. It's unlikely, I think, that the radio would work downstairs. It seems like it'd be tough to get a signal down there. But, okay, sorry, I had to edit out a yawn there. Okay, so rather than meet this head on and talk about staff moving upstairs and downstairs, Dwayne shifts tactics a little bit, starts talking about another discussion they had concerning the strength of the zombies and how that relates to the place being safe. Dwayne says, look, I smashed three of these things and I pushed another one out the door. They're not that strong. Harry responds by saying, I'm telling you they are strong because they pushed over my car onto its roof. Then Dwayne says, oh, well, any five men could do that, right? So what's going on here, right? Well, we've got these arguments on the left. And the question is, how strong are the zombies? Initially, Dwayne seems to have a point that, look, the zombies aren't any stronger than five or six men. They could probably turn over a car on its side, right? So he's saying, look, the zombies are not very strong, so the zombies couldn't get through the windows boarded upstairs. I put the upstairs wood. I'm sorry about that, you guys. It should say the windows boarded upstairs. Thus, the cellar is not the safest place, right? Now, Harry actually makes probably his finest move in the whole dialogue, right? He says, that's my point, right? That it doesn't matter that the zombies aren't individually strong. That's not really what I'm saying. There's not going to be five of them that you've pushed out the door. There's going to be 30, 100. Who knows? And once we're in here, this place will be crawling with them. And so he's saying this little argument on the left, the zombies aren't very strong individually. There's going to be a lot of them. The zombies will be strong all together. And so the zombies can break through the boarded windows. And so the cellar would be the safest place, right? Now, Dwayne, man, hard-hitting Dwayne makes a great point here. He says, look, he's going to run a reductio himself. And he's going to say, the zombies, you're right, the zombies will be strong collectively. And so if there are going to be that many zombies, then they're going to break through boarded windows or anything wherever we are. And so no place is safe. And so the cellar is not the safest place. This is a reductio. He says, look, if what you're saying is true, if there's going to be 100 zombies coming at this house simultaneously, then they're going to break in anywhere we are, whether we're upstairs or downstairs. So your argument is too strong, right? It shows too much. So now they shift tactics again, right? They shift tactics again, and Harry says, look, okay, in the cellar, there's one point. There's one door. That's the only place we have to protect. And Dom and I, Tom and I, who I guess they were compadres or something, fix it up so it locks and boards from the inside. But all these doors and windows, why? Well, they never know where they're going to hit us next. So Harry gives us a more positive reason here. The cellar has a feature that the upstairs doesn't, and this makes it superior. There's only one door that has to be secured. And it's true that you could secure against a door against zombies, which seems to be the essence of Dwayne's argument. He thinks that you can secure a place, right? At least in some measure from zombies by boarding them up or whatever. And so we could make the cellar the safest place. And so here's his argument on the right. It's easier to protect one entry point than multiple entry points. The cellar has one entry point, thus the cellar is easier to protect. Thus, the cellar is the safest place. All right, but now, Dwayne is not going to be undone here, right? He says, look, okay, you know, you have a point in the cellar that there's no place to run, right? This is right. You're right, there's only one entry point, but that's not necessarily a good thing, right? You're correct. It would be easier to defend one spot. But this is also for the same fact cuts both ways. The same point that there's only one entry point makes it worse, not better. And so he employs the same kind of argument here. It's easier to protect one entry point rather than multiple entry points. It's better to have multiple retreat paths rather than one, right? If it's good to have one path of retreat, it would be even better to have two. The cellar only has one retreat path, and this is where the real snafu comes in, right? The cellar's retreat path would be blocked by the invasion. So the cellar has no retreat path at all. The upstairs has multiple retreat paths, and so the upstairs would be the safest place, right? And this is a really good point. If the choke point does fail, which if there were hundreds and hundreds of zombies, it probably would, then we couldn't do anything, right? We would be stuck in there and we'd become zombies ourselves. I want to just bring up one final thing here as we kind of close out, because they just reiterate their original points, and unfortunately Dwayne's lines get cut there from the screen. There's something that Mr. Cooper fails to do, right? I think if Mr. Cooper was a brighter bulb, he was a little bit smarter, he'd studied a little more logic, he could have actually appealed to Dwayne's humanity and say, look, I get you. We can't, I'm sorry for the capital A there. We can't take advantage of all these retreat routes because we have an injured party. And this is his child, right? His daughter. And so this is the unspoken assumption that he doesn't seem to be able to, you know, employ in his rational defense. He can't say, look, yeah, there's multiple retreat routes, but it doesn't matter because I have somebody who's so sick she can't move. And so retreat isn't really an option because our mobility is so limited. I honestly think that if he had made that argument, I don't know what Dwayne would have said in response, but it would have moved the discussion forward, right? So again, the important thing here is to look at premises and conclusions. And although this is one small 5-minute clip from a horror movie, you can see how logic is important when you're trying to convince somebody of something or demonstrate that, well, look, I would think your way, except this is the way that I think about it. and the impact that it can have on your own actions and the actions of people around you. Okay, you guys, I'm going to just chat for just a smidge about Night of the Living Dead. If you do not want to hear me sort of, if you don't want any spoilers about the end of the movie, that's fine. If you'd like to know a little philosophy with regard to the movie, then just hang out for like a minute or two. When you see the blue, if you're fast forwarding, when you see the blue tile that says kinds of arguments, then that'll be fine. You'll be good there. Okay. I just have a quote here from Jordan Peele. Many of you might know, very famous, producer, actor, comedian, writer, general thinker. And he writes, theoretically, their racial perspective is the very skill that helps them. He's talking about Night of the Living Dead and the characters within Night of the Living Dead. You could write an interesting essay about how the lead in Night of the Living Dead is a man living in fear every day. So this is a challenge he's more equipped to take on than the white woman living in the house. The truck driver in his racial paranoia is on to something that he wouldn't be if he was a white guy and there was a similar thing going on. I think that's right. And you would add to that essay, I think there's a little tension there between Mr. Cooper, a.k.a. Mr. Tinsdale, and the truck driver. It does seem like there's a little more going on there. And so I do think that race has a big, big part to play in it. And then you could expand out that essay quite a bit. Just a quick side note, too, on the side, on the very ending, the actor who plays Ben, our truck driver, writes, apparently the movie had a different ending. This is definitely a spoiler, so if you don't want to hear it, don't. He was apparently going to live through. He doesn't live through in the end. And he's reflecting on this years later, and he says, I convinced George that the black community would rather see me dead than saved. After all that had gone on, in a corny and symbolically confusing way, besides, said Jones, the heroes never die in American movies. The jolt of that and the double jolt of the hero figure being black seem like a double-barreled whammy. That's right. I think that that's really a profound point. And at the end of the movie, the person who kills him is a white man. It's a group of white men with guns. And you might make the argument that they actually see him and know that he's not a zombie and they still shoot him. But it's excellent. And just if you're interested, you can use zombies to talk about all sorts of different things in philosophy. I use them to teach social contract theory and political philosophy, and that it fits like a glove, Thomas Hobbes' State of Nature. So it just goes to show you, I mean, zombies are fun and interesting, but also I think it shows you really and truly philosophy underlies a lot of the stuff that we do because it asks so many of the most fundamental questions that we have. Okay, moving on. Now we're talking about kinds of arguments. We're going to be covering two kinds of arguments generally, and then I'm going to mention a third kind of argument, a type of reasoning. But before we get into all that stuff, I just wanted to address the difference between an argument and an explanation. Now, I'm not going to test very heavily on this. You might have one true or false question on it, and it would surround right here this note. But it's an important distinction to make, otherwise you might get caught up in it. An argument that attempts to show why its conclusion is true is an explanation. So the best way to kind of bring this about is I show you an explanation rather than an argument, to look at Alice in Wonderland, where she goes in, I think it's chapter 5 or chapter 9, I'm not entirely sure, where she runs into these cards. Right, she runs into the rose garden, and these bloats, these cats, are painting the roses red. And if you've seen the Walt Disney version, even if you haven't, it says, "Oh, pardon me, but Mr. Three," this is Alice, "why must you paint them red?" Right, she wants to know why you're painting these roses red. And they respond, "The queen, she likes them red. If she saw white instead, she'd raise her voice, and each of us would quickly lose his head." So she's saying, look, you know, she understands that they're painting the roses red. What she wants to know is, why are you doing that, right? That's the difference between an argument and an explanation. I'm not going to test very heavily on this, but the general idea is you're seeking something that explains why this conclusion is true or why this is so, right? So I understand you're painting these roses, but why is this being done? That's an explanation, not an argument. The same thing you can see here, I just put the text on the screen from the original book. Would you tell me, said Alice, a little timidly, why you're painting those roses, right? She knows that they're painting the roses, but why are they doing that, right? That's what an explanation is. Sure, you're painting the roses, but why is that true? That's the difference between an argument and an explanation. And they say, essentially, if the queen was to find out, she would have all of our heads cut off, you know. We're doing our best before she comes to, you know, paint them red. All right, so there we go on that. Remember, that's just the difference between an argument and an explanation. Okay, we are going to discuss deduction versus induction. Deduction and induction. You see a werewolf there. It's pretty annoying now that I see it, so I'm going to zip past it super quick. All right. On your screen is a drawing of a story. It's a Greek myth where this cat called King Lycon, it's Lycaon, invites Zeus over to dinner. And he invites Zeus over for dinner because he wants to see if Zeus is really omniscient, if Zeus knows everything. And what he does is he somehow figures out a way to do this. I don't know how. He actually kills one of Zeus's children, and then he's going to try to feed him, this child, to Zeus. Now, it seems strange to me that if Zeus really was omniscient, couldn't Zeus just know that he wanted to know this and tell him or something like that? But anyway, it doesn't work out real well for King Lycon. He serves Zeus, his son's flesh, to see if Zeus was all-knowing, and guess what? Zeus was. And so he turns the king into a wolf. As a curse. This is the beginning of the King Lycon story. And so you'll sometimes hear the study of werewolves referred to as lycanthropy. It's the same root, lycanthropy, lycanthropy, from King Lycon, the story. That's the Western version of it. But you should note that a number of different cultures around the world have stories of people turning into whatever the local apex predator is. So there are stories in India of people turning into tigers and so forth. So there's all sorts of stories like that. But this helps us because werewolves are a monster and they will help us learn a little bit about logic. And remember, this is kind of fun because monsters are sort of outside the realm of logic. They're outside the realm of rational explanation. Okay, modernly, we think of werewolves as individuals who turn into a wolf upon a full moon, right? And that's different from the original story, but still, that's the root for it from Western civilization. Now, why does this matter? Well, I want to use this piece of common knowledge to give you a couple different examples of how you might orchestrate or how you might generate an argument. So here's an argument. Premise one, if someone is a werewolf, then he, she, they will turn into a wolf when the moon is full. Premise two, Jacob Black is a werewolf. Conclusion three, thus, Jacob Black will turn into a wolf when the moon is full. Look, if one and two are true, then three has to be true, right? It's an argument form called modus ponens. This is called a deductive argument. And what I want to point out to you here is that the arguer intends that one and two will force three to be true. In other words, they intend an absolute support relationship between the premises and the conclusion. That's what tells us what deduction is. Deduction is when an arguer intends an absolute support relationship between the premise and conclusion. A better way to put it, and this is the way that you should know, a deductive argument is when the arguer intends that if the premises are true, then the conclusion must be true. All right, this is called deduction. So that's your screen. That's what you need to know. Deduction is when the arguer intends that if the premises are true, then the conclusion must be true. Remember, arguments have three parts, right? They have premise, they have a conclusion, and then they have an inference or support relationship. And in this case, we're talking about all three, right? Okay, so let me give you another example. A silver bullet will kill any werewolf. That's premise one. Premise two, Jacob Black is a werewolf. Conclusion three, thus a silver bullet will kill Jacob. There you go, that's it. If one and two are true, three has to be true. Remember, and that conforms because the arguer intends here that if the premises are true, then the conclusion must also be true. All right. Now, there's another kind of argument. It's called induction. And induction, you know, let me give you an example. Let me just point out something. It's just a mnemonic with regard to deduction. If one and two are true, then three has got to be true, correct? So you might say, look, if one and two are true, then three has to be true. One and two are true, so three has to be true, okay? That is deduction. That's deduction, right? It's when if the premises are true, the conclusion has to be true. That's deduction. But induction is when the premises support the conclusion, but it's not a slam dunk, right? It's induction is when the arguer intends that if the premises are true, then they support the conclusion. The conclusion's probably true, but it's not totally all the way there. Now, induction gets broken down into two other parts, right? There's strong induction and there's weak induction. Strong induction is when the premises support the conclusion more than 50%. Weak induction is when the premises support the conclusion 50% or less. Okay, that's the general idea. Now, it can be hard to assess some of the borderline cases of strong versus weak induction. And, you know, you might make the case that one person's weak argument is another person's strong argument on the basis of prior probabilities or just their own subjective probabilities or something like that. So we're not going to spend a ton of time looking at the features of inductive arguments or the difference between strong or weak induction, but you should know that there is a difference, an intelligible difference between strong and weak induction. Okay. Okay, so now I have a quick example here of induction. And unfortunately, the numbers are cut off the screen, but that's okay, you don't need them. So you have a series of premises here, you have four of them, and then you have a conclusion. So the first premise says, on January's full moon, Jacob turned into a werewolf. Premise two, on February's full moon, Jacob turned into a werewolf. Premise three, on March's full moon, Jacob turned into a werewolf. Premise four, on April's full moon, Jacob turned into a werewolf. And then conclusion number five, thus on March's full moon, Jacob Black will probably turn into a werewolf. You notice here that, you know, someone has turned into a werewolf for the last 5 months on the full moon. Chances are better than 50% that it's going to happen that next month, right? It'll probably happen. But it could turn out that does not happen, that it doesn't obtain, that the person doesn't do that. Maybe they die before this occurs. Maybe they find the werewolf that bit them and kill that werewolf. Something like that, right? I have a similar argument here that you can see with regard to silver bullets killing werewolves. I just want to throw out for the cryptozoology folks out there, there's a fascinating story of a creature that was killed in France, Gévaudan, France. I think I'm saying that wrong. Gévaudan. If you know French and you want to let me know, please let me know. It's been too long. There's this fascinating story that there was a wolf of some kind that was killed. And they had counted the number of teeth and recorded the number of teeth. And I think there's a problem. I don't think the number of teeth corresponds to any known species or something like that. Anyway, suppose that you have a recorded account, right, and it's true that a silver bullet killed a werewolf in 1767. Then you've got another story of a silver bullet killing a werewolf in Buenos Aires in 1843. Then you've got another story of a silver bullet killing a werewolf in Redlands, California in 1975. Then you've got another story of a silver bullet killing a werewolf in Long Beach, 2004. Now, this werewolf is staring at you right there, super scary. What are you going to do, right? Hopefully you would conclude that this silver bullet will kill this werewolf. But remember, we're dealing with induction here. And the problem with induction is that just because it's improbable that the conclusion is false. It doesn't mean that it's impossible. In other words, what's most important about induction is that the support relationship between premises and conclusions is less than absolute. And by the way, this is an LAFC cup, so good stuff. So that's what's important to remember. The biggest difference between induction and deduction is the degree of support between the premises and the conclusions. And if you can remember, induction means kind of the premises support the conclusion, then you've got it, because then you remember deduction is the other one where, duh, the premises totally support the conclusion. Okay, here's a bit of information. I don't know that I'm going to test super heavily on this, but you should know, right? Sometimes you look at an argument and you're just not sure whether that argument is inductive or deductive. This certainly happens. There are different ways to assess this. One of the ways that you can do this is by looking at the support relationship. If it's 100%, then the argument is very likely a deductive one. You can still have a deductive argument where someone tries to make a deductive argument. They intend to, but they don't actually make it. In other words, the premises don't completely support the conclusion, but you could still, in that kind of a case, say, well, it's a deductive because, remember, it's what the arguer intends or what someone intends. Okay, that's one and two. Next, you'd look at the character or form of the argument, right? Is it one of the specific types of inductive argumentation that we're going to look at later? Is it induction by analogy, generalization, authority, sign, or prediction? Or is it a specific kind of deductive argument? We won't go into these too much, sentential, categorical, or mathematical. If it's one of those three, and again, we're not going to cover that stuff, then you would know. Another way to do this is to look for indicator words, and I've taught courses where we look at just pages and pages and pages and pages of passages and arguments where people are circling indicator words and so forth. Words like thus are usually show a deductive argument, but not necessarily. There's no rule. You could certainly have thus at the end of an inductive argument. But if you see the word probably, likely, will, those are usually inductive. Interesting question as to whether or not the word shall would be used in an inductive argument, but we're just moving right on. Okay. All right. Is this argument inductive or deductive? Is this reasoning induction or deduction? Here we go. By definition, a monster is monstrous. The monster either lacks or possesses some important element that would normally make one human. The Zodiac Killer is a moral monster. Period. He is therefore morally monstrous. All right. What would that be? That would be deductive, because the very first line says, by definition, a monster is monstrous. Right. And then I'm telling you that the Zodiac Killer is a moral monster. So I'm telling you he's a monster, and I'm saying that a monster is monstrous, and therefore the Zodiac Killer is a moral monster, and he's therefore morally monstrous. It's just true by definition, right? By the way, in the upper right-hand corner here, I have a small GIF that shows some of the letters from the Zodiac Killer. Last semester, I almost did a module on the Zodiac Killer. I ran out of time, but you can do a lot with this case. You can show some interesting things about logic and syntax, as well as you can do a whole series on abduction about it, abductive reasoning. Okay, next up, is the following argument induction or deduction? Right. Premise one: all vampires suck blood. Premise two, Vlad Tepes is a vampire. Conclusion three, thus Vlad Tepes sucks blood. Okay, this would be a deductive argument, right? This would be called categorical. You don't need to know that, but the idea is you're relating categories of things, right? All vampires have this predicate, right, that they suck blood. Vlad Tepes is a member of this class. Right, and thus he has this trait too. All right, next up, induction or deduction. I've seen four LBCC students walk out of that horror film. The students here probably do not have very good taste. Okay, that would be inductive. Because, look, I'm trying to jump from the students that I've seen walk out of a horror film to a statement about a class of people. I'm going from confirmed perceived instances to unperceived unconfirmed instances. That is definitely induction, because even though I might have a good sample, it may not be enough to guarantee the truth of the conclusion, because the individuals might have that trait and those individuals might accurately represent a cross-section of people at LBCC, but those people not having good taste doesn't then have anything to do with the other people on campus having good taste. All right, here's another example of an argument. I tried Indian food once when I was 8 and hated it. Conclusion, thus I hate all Indian food, right? So this would be an inductive argument, and it would be a terrible one, right? This would be hasty generalization. You have to be careful. You might have gone to the wrong restaurant. You might have tasted the food when you were too young and your taste buds have changed. You might have gotten in trouble at the restaurant and that ruined the experience for you. You have to be very careful when you generalize from a case of one or a limited number of cases and then project some trait onto the unseen, unperceived instances on the basis of what you've seen in the perceived instance. Okay, next up we're going to talk about specific types of induction. This is an important area just to know, just to have your finger on a little bit. There are different kinds of induction, and this shouldn't come as too big of a surprise. It's kind of a big toolbox, right, with lots of different things in it. But there's an easy way to remember the different kinds of induction, and so I've presented this for you here. We're not going to cover all of these kinds of induction, but some of them we will take a peek at, and some of them will be tested, so I'll do my best to fill you in here. All right. What do you do when you see a monster? Right? You gasp, right? You let out a gasp. That's what you do. You gasp. It's a monster, right? And that's your mnemonic for remembering the different kinds of induction. So here we have induction by analogy, induction by generalization, induction by authority, induction by sign, and induction by prediction. I'm so sorry, I have a little yawn there, everybody. All right, induction by analogy. This is when you have two things and you say, look, this thing has these traits, this thing has these traits, this thing has this other trait, so this thing probably also has this trait. Now, formally, you'd represent this as object X has PQR, object Y has PQR, object X has T, thus probably Y also has T. You don't know whether it has T or not, but you're guessing that it has T. One of the most famous examples of induction by analogy is the watchmaker argument. And I just wanted to draw your attention to this. You've heard this argument, I'm sure. I want to read this quote first from Cicero, from his On the Nature of the Gods. When you see a sundial or a water clock, you see that it tells the time by design and not by chance. How then can you imagine that the universe as a whole is devoid of purpose and intelligence when it embraces everything, including these artifacts themselves and their artificers? There is a type of argument called the watchmaker argument. This is the source of it. Now, that particular translation, the way that this looks, I did a couple things there. I cut off the bit that comes before it, and we're using a specific translation, and so you could interpret that as a deductive argument. However, a guy named William Paley takes that passage and then himself creates a very famous kind of teleological argument for the existence of God. And the argument goes something like this. Premise one, Premise one, a clock is complex. Premise two, a clock has a designer. Premise three, the universe is complex. Conclusion four, thus the universe also has a designer. So the idea here is exactly what we had formalized in the prior slide. I've got two things. This thing has this trait. This thing also has this trait. this thing has this other trait, and so I'm concluding that this thing probably also has this trait. Now, as it turns out, this argument has not fared well. This version of the argument, the teleological argument by analogy, hasn't fared very well due to the work of someone named David Hume, who comes along and in a work called The Dialogues Concerning Natural Religion, you don't need to know this, really delivers a devastating series of criticisms of this argument. But remember, philosophers don't want to give up the ghost, right? You want to keep going. And what people have done is they've reformulated this argument to take a different form a little bit later on. And it becomes an argument from the best explanation. So you can certainly reformulate this argument. Just a little bit of backstory. But, you know, it's very intuitive, right? You're walking on an island, you see a watch. It's obviously been designed. It's super complex. You can tell it didn't happen by accident. But, you know, the beach, on the other hand, has all of these, you know, accidental pieces of driftwood and so forth. And so then you can conclude that the watch has been designed. But then when you look at the universe, you look at this planet, you even look at your body, you can say, gosh, you know, it does look like there's a tremendous amount of complexity there too. So for instance, if your blood becomes too acidic, right? If the pH level in your blood gets too high, your body will actually leach calcium from your bones and distribute it through the blood so that you don't cook your own organs in, you know, bloody acid. I mean, you know, it's wild stuff. That kind of precision and complexity, you see that in the human body. You don't see that in random arrangements of matter. And so it looks like, by analogy, you conclude that, you know, God exists or a designer exists. Super intuitive argument, really interesting area of philosophy. Lots of stuff to talk about there, but we're moving on. Okay. Induction by generalization. This is when you move from a trait about specific members of a group to the trait of a group. And you got to be careful here. But you'd say something like, I've really liked 4 out of the 10 vampire movies I've seen. Thus, I probably like 40% of the vampire movies out there. You know, who knows? Maybe the out of those 10 that you've seen, 6 of them were super old and you don't like old movies. And it turns out the percentage of vampire movies that you like is actually much higher. But you get the general idea. You're moving from a couple of instances to a more broad array. Induction by authority. We use this a lot. It's just the nature of our intellectual division of labor. I'm not an economist. I don't know what's going on in the economy. When I turn on, you know, the news, I assume that they know what they mean when they're talking about the LIBOR rate and how that relates to inflation and what employment numbers mean. And I mean, I don't know, right? And so when you hear somebody say something who is an expert on a topic you don't know about, their kind of testimony raises the probability that what they're saying is true. You have to be very careful here, though, not to commit this fallacy. Remember, we talked about way back in the first module where we discussed Jane Goodall. Just because somebody is an authority on something doesn't make what they say true. It just makes it more probable than what they're saying is true. So here's a classic example. Boyd Bushman, a Lockheed Martin scientist with top secret clearance, says extraterrestrial aliens crashed at Roswell. That's our premise. Thus, aliens crashed at Roswell. Remember, you want to... I'm so sorry, you guys. Folks, that's just terrible. You want to just recognize that some authority making a statement on something on which they are an authority makes it more probable than what they're saying is true, but it doesn't actually make it true. So make sure you're talking about probabilities and not absolute, right? By the way, this is Bushman's alien photo here that he took. This was to help substantiate his claims that he had this photo of an alien. And then on the right, you can see a Walmart alien doll. And that's from Rational Wiki, if you want to take a peek. So that kind of goes from there. Look, Induction by authority is an essential form of reasoning. We use it all the time, but you have to be careful. Very often, networks will just hire dueling experts, and these people just are hired to lie. In those cases, it's on you to figure out what is correct and what is false. It's just the way it is. Induction by design, I'm not going to test you on this. Argument that proceeds from knowledge of a sign to the thing that the sign symbolizes. Induction by prediction, an argument that proceeds from knowledge of the past to knowledge of the future. So this was the example involving the werewolves and the silver bullets, right? This has happened in the past, therefore it will happen in the future. The underlying assumption there is a uniformity of nature argument that the past will resemble the future. And you can't just say the past will resemble the future because in the past has resembled the future, right? That would be circular. You have to expressly assume that. All right. Okay. Let's talk about abduction. This is not alien abduction. It's abduction as in abductive reasoning, as in inference to the best explanation. What explanation best explains the facts or the data that we have available to us? We're going to do this by bringing attention to a little section of Alice in Wonderland where Alice meets a monster. She actually meets a monster in Alice in Wonderland. Just to rehash here what I said, abductive arguments are different than either induction or deduction. Abductive arguments do not seek to prove or support, but explain. In its most broad sense, abductive arguments are known as inferences to the best explanation. And there should be an end of the quote there, but there isn't. Abductive arguments do not concern premises and conclusions, but instead data and an explanation, right? So what is the data and what's the best explanation for that data? We want to find the best explanation given the data we are given. So I'm going to give you two examples of abduction. The first one is where Alice meets a monster, and the second one is actually similar in theme, but involves the Greek myth of the Cyclops. It's actually also present in Roman mythology and so forth. All right, so there is a picture of a griffin. That's not normally how we spell it. That is how Lewis Carroll spells it in Alice in Wonderland. And at one point in Alice in Wonderland, this is chapter 9, it reads, "They very soon came upon a griffin lying fast asleep in the sun. If you don't know what a griffin is, look at the picture." And that was actually the picture. "Up, lazy thing," said the queen, "and take this young lady to see the mock turtle and to hear his story. I must go back and see after some executions I have ordered." And she walked off, leaving Alice alone with the griffin. Okay. The griffin is considered the most noble of beasts. It has the head of an eagle and the body of a lion. And you can see that here. Now, if you were sort of reading Alice in Wonderland when it was published, you would find this hilarious. And the reason why is griffins were thought to be the most tenacious and most noble of creatures. That's because they had the apex predator of the sky, right, with the eagle, and then the same thing with the lion there too, right? It's like the two most powerful, the most powerful bird and the most powerful animal combined into one. There are something called hippogriffs. It's a little bit different. That actually has the front of an eagle and the back of a horse. Harry Potter's all about the hippogriffs, but we won't get into it. They're typically depicted as being very vigilant and powerful beasts. They're very, very strong. They're thought to guard gold or extremely valuable treasures. When Alice goes on here, she says, we read, "Alice did not quite like the look of the creature, but on the whole, she thought it would be quite as safe to stay with it as to go after that savage queen. The griffin sat up and rubbed its eyes. 'What fun,' said the griffin, half to itself, half to Alice. 'What is the fun?' said Alice. 'Why, she,' said the griffin.
And then I'll kind of, it's all her fancy, that. They never executes nobody, you know. Come on. Okay. I mentioned earlier, if you were reading this when Alice in Wonderland came out, you would find this very amusing. And the reason why is griffins are supposed to be very astute and acute and alert and tenacious. And the idea that one of them would be sleeping, right, and it would need to rub its eyes and sit up would just, it would be kind of absurd. He knows that, and he thinks this is very funny. But, I mean, you know, times have changed, right? So it's not quite as available to us, so it's not quite as funny. Also, his language here is a bit funny. They were considered to be royal beasts because they guarded gold and so forth, these valuable treasures. And so for him to say something like, they never executes nobody, you know, that's, he's poking a little fun there. That's less than proper English. And so it's kind of a joke that this is this sleepy, poorly spoken griffin, and it's meant to be funny. This is Oxford, and I forget which college it is, but this is one of the crests. It might be Oxford itself. It might be the university crest, but I think it's a college. And they have a griffin on there. There are lots of references to Oxford throughout Alice in Wonderland. The root, the Greek word root, means hooked. And griffins actually have a super long history in the world. We have Aristeus talking about them in 7th century BCE. And also, there is a wonderful palace on the island of Crete in Knossos. And in this palace, we have a picture of a griffin. And so this has been around for thousands of years. This critter has been around for thousands of years, ever since we've had critters. In fact, they found some mummified nomad tombs. And on those nomads, there were actually tattoos of griffins. Okay, so here's a drawing of the tattoos. If you don't want to see the tattoos themselves, you might want to blink your eyes. Because I mean, I don't think it's gross, but I've taken some anthropology and that can be kind of graphic. But you might not want to see the next picture, but you can see there are griffins there. So it's pretty nutty that this would be there. So I'm going to flip to the next page, which is a little bit graphic. Keep your eyes closed if you don't want to see it. There's the actual mummy. And you can see there's the actual griffin. Pretty wild, right? For thousands of these creatures. And these mummified remains were found in this area that we can define as Scythian or Scythia. And if you want to know what the Scythians were like, they were kind of like the Dothraki. They were nomadic people who would ride from place to place. And they're defined by a cluster of things. I think one of the features has to do with we can find remnants of their riding mounts or something like that, like the way that they mounted their critters. We have, like, I don't know if they're bolts or something like that, but we have some remnants of their riding attire. And then also, I think the way that they would weave baskets or make clay, and then something else. But what's interesting is that we have people who are riding around through this area, tattooing themselves with these images of griffins. And you might say, okay, well, is this a logic class? Like, what are we talking about here? What are you doing, right? I'm sniffing a lot of glue here. Okay. And so these Scythians, who were kind of like the Dothraki, right? They moved from place to place. They were these nomadic, powerful people, and also a stable culture, apparently, over time. They would have these images tattooed on themselves, with the head of an eagle and the body of a lion. And people, you know, thought about this like they would think about the Greeks talking about griffins. It was sort of like, or, how silly, you know, the Greeks would just make it up. I guess they're just making it up, right? They're sniffing glue, and then they're saying, hey, I'm gonna come up with this creature, and it's gonna take the best bird and the best lion, and I'm gonna combine them, and that's gonna be called a griffin, right? Well, when you look in these regions, there are some fossilized dinosaur remnants. And these fossilized dinosaur remnants
are found near to or in proximate relation to gold deposits. Okay, so this might seem pretty far out, but stick with me. What people figure happened was, what scholars assume has happened was, these people were cruising around in the mountains, and they probably would find some of these fossilized dinosaur remnants. Maybe they found one or two, who knows? And they saw that this head looked like an eagle, right? And the body looked like a lion, maybe? And they'd say it was by a bunch of gold or where there was gold. And they'd say, well, gosh, it looks like this thing got wiped out guarding all this gold. And lo and behold, now we have these stories being transferred all over the ancient world about creatures with the head of an eagle and the body of a lion, and they protect gold. Well, this is abduction. That's probably what happened. We can't know for sure, but that's probably what happened, right? Be an inductive kind of thing, if you want to get all meta. But you'd see, you know, premise one, the skeleton head looks like an eagle, does it? Yes, it does. It looks like a massive eagle head. I mean, if you didn't know what a dinosaur was, the resemblance relation is there. Even if maybe that's not terribly similar to an eagle's skull, but it looks like an eagle, right? And the skeleton body kind of looks like a lion's body. And I found that skeleton near gold. So the animal had the head of an eagle, the body of a lion, and was guarding gold. Ain't that hard to figure out? Must have been unbelievable to them to see something like that. They wouldn't know what dinosaurs were. They wouldn't have a clue. And they must have figured that these things were real, or at one time they were real. They had no idea that that's what, you know, Protoceratops would have looked like. But it was the best that they could do. Now, I want to cover one more example of this, of abduction, dealing with monsters. It has to do with Cyclops. Cyclops are Greek figures originally. We find them in Hesiod. I'll get to that in a second. But the idea is, this is a Roman bust of a Cyclops. And I think this is like between the 1st and 2nd century BCE. I'm not sure, but to my recollection, that's right. What is distinctive to a Cyclops is that it has the head of, it's big, and it has one eye, right? So in the Theogony written by Hesiod, and we don't, remember, we ain't worried about dates, okay? We don't want to be bogged down by the facts. He says, and again, she, and this is Gaia, Mother Earth, bear the Cyclops, overbearing in spirit, Brontes and Steropes and stubborn-hearted Arges, who gave Zeus the thunder and made the thunderbolt. These Cyclops are often depicted as kind of like blacksmiths, right? They like build these things. But one eye only was set in the midst of their foreheads, and they were surnamed Cyclops, orb-eyed, because one orbed eye was set in their foreheads. Strength and might and craft were in their works. Okay, well, hold on to your hats, because in Greece, they find remnants of, drumroll, mastodons. And you can find these things. They're not super common, but you can find them in caves once in a while. You can find the skull of an old mastodon. Well, you're some Greek, right? I mean, you don't know what that is. It certainly looks like a head that has one eye. You know, it wouldn't be too hard to just totally anthropomorphize and say, well, it must just be that there's one eye that goes there. And the head is super big. It belonged to a mastodon. So this must have been a giant who had one eye. This would be a case of abduction, right? And so we wouldn't use these as premises, but I've laid them out as premises and conclusions. But the idea is you have a set of facts, right? You've got this skull. It's huge. It's got one cavity. Gosh, this thing must have been huge, must have had one eye, because our skulls have two cavities and we have two eyes. Best explanation, this belonged to a huge, massive creature. Okay, so now let's just talk briefly here about features of arguments. Features of arguments. Now, this is the meat and the potatoes of logic, right? It's something called validity.
at least for deductive logic. We won't spend too much time with inductive logic, but we'll spend some time with deductive logic here.
Okay, and we are on to features of arguments. Features of arguments is really the meat and potatoes of this. Everything has been building up to it. You'll know why premises and conclusions have to be statements, why we needed to distinguish between induction and deduction. It's because when we understand that stuff, then we are able to understand why objectively some arguments are better than others. Remember, if we just get into this space where any opinion is better, as good as any other opinion, then no opinion is better than any other opinion. And so argumentation and reason help us to evaluate positions in real life. So let's get crack-a-lackin' here. All right, first thing that we're going to focus on are features of deduction. We're going to worry about features of deduction far more than we worry about the features of induction. Features of deduction, I want you to remember, for validity and soundness, the Hulk. Now, why? Well, because the Hulk just smashes, right? The Hulk smash, right? We all remember Captain America saying that. It's because the Hulk has this unearthly amount of strength, and he's able to just crush things. Right? It seems as though nothing can stop him. Well, that is true of arguments that are valid and sound, right? They are just very powerful. And if you can articulate an argument that is valid and sound, you will have rationally demonstrated yourself to another person. So, first up, validity. Quick side note, validity and soundness do not apply to statements, they apply to arguments. This is very important. A statement is not valid. A statement is not sound. An argument is valid. An argument is sound. A statement is true or false. All right, so now, an argument is valid. This is our first definition. If the premises are true, then the conclusion must also be true. Or, there's a second definition, it is not possible for the premises to be true and the conclusion to be false. So, these definitions should look very similar to you. You might even think that they're the same. For our purposes here, we will treat them as the same, but there are a certain class of arguments where they might diverge a little, and we're just not going to get into it. So we'll treat them as the same. Either will be fine, but know that there is a small class of arguments that might make it a little more interesting. But don't worry about it. So that's validity. Let me give you an example of a valid argument. All professors are happy. That's premise one. Premise two, Roberto is a professor. Conclusion, thus Roberto is happy. Now, this argument is valid because if one and two are true, they force three to be true, right? There's no way that one and two can be true and three is false. So if we look at our two definitions, right, that's the first one. If one and two are true, then three must be true. Because we know one is talking about a class of things and saying of those things that they have a trait. Then two is talking about an individual within that class and then ascribing that trait to it would be conclusion three. Now, it's not possible for one to be true, two to be true, and three to be false. And this is the essence of validity. Now, soundness is a little bit different. And so we're going to just talk about soundness right now. Soundness is a valid argument whose premises are actually true, as in the real world, actually true. So, for example, premise one, all flowers are plants. Premise two, all daisies are flowers. Conclusion, therefore, all daisies are plants. So, the argument's valid, meaning if one and two were true, then three would be true. And the argument is sound because it's actually the case that all flowers are plants, and it's actually the case that all daisies are flowers. And so we know that the conclusion must be true that all daisies are plants. Okay, now, you're looking at a picture of the first patented exercise, like gym equipment. And this picture helps us figure out a little bit about what we'll be doing with the next portion of the video. And that is, we're going to be working through some examples of valid and sound arguments.
And that's just the best way to learn this stuff. You may feel an intuitive grasp of validity and soundness, but you may realize that your understanding is deepened by working through examples. So let's work through a series of examples. All right, this is an argument. I'll read it. Premise one, all humans have hearts. Premise two, Sid is a human. Conclusion three, Sid has a heart. Okay, now, is this argument valid? That's the first thing I want you to think about. So maybe you want to pause it, look at your notes. What is a valid argument? So pause it for a second. Is this argument valid? Okay, now that you've determined that, I want you to think, is this argument sound? Importantly, remember, if you have determined that this argument is not valid, then this argument cannot be sound and you're done. But if this argument is valid, you then need to think about, is this argument sound? Okay, now, let's talk about the answer. Okay, this argument is both valid and sound in the following sense. Okay, this argument is valid because it's not possible for one and two to be true and three to be false. Meaning, if it's true that all humans have hearts, and it's true that Sid is a human, then we can conclude that it's also true that Sid has a heart. So that would be a valid argument, right? It's not possible for one and two to be true and three to be false, right? The truth of one and two guarantee three is also true, right? It's not possible for the premises to be true and the conclusion to be false. That's validity. Now, soundness. Is this argument sound? Well, it depends. I'd need to clarify if I was asking you this question on an exam. Depends on who Sid is, right? Look, all humans have hearts. Yeah, we could grant that. I mean, there are people who are walking around, maybe with artificial hearts or something like that, or people don't. They're still alive, but for moments during a heart transplant, they don't have a heart or something like that. But generally speaking, right, we can say, yeah, it's true that all humans have hearts. Maybe you've dated somebody that doesn't have a heart. I get it. But generally speaking, we all agree that humans have hearts. Okay. Premise two, Sid is a human. You notice I have this picture up here of Sid Vicious. Let's just assume that Sid Vicious is a human, and let's assume that he's alive, right? And so in that case, this argument would be sound, right? So soundness asks, are the premises actually true? So is it actually true that all humans have hearts? Yep. And is it actually true that Sid is a human? Well, it does, but it depends on what the term Sid refers to. Now, you will never be in an exam position where it's unclear if an argument is sound because you don't know who Sid is or who John is, right? You say, well, you say John is a human, but I don't know who John is. Is John your dog or is, you know, okay, fair enough. I'll never put you in a situation like that. Again, we're just working through some examples right here in order to kind of make things make sense. Okay. Here we go. Next example. Premise one, all humans have three heads. Premise two, Kobe is a human. Conclusion, thus, Kobe has three heads. Okay, stop and ask yourself, is this argument valid? You can pause if you want. Okay, in order to determine if an argument is valid, I'm asking you, is it possible for one and two to be true and three to be false? Well, if it's true that all humans have heads, three heads, and if it's true that Kobe is a human, then are we forced to conclude that Kobe has three heads? Yes, right? That's validity. Now, remember, validity says if one and two are true, do they guarantee three? Validity does not ask, well, is one actually true? If we're asking whether or not the premise is actually true in the world, we're talking about soundness. Okay, so soundness has to do with what's out there in the world, just kind of like sound waves have to do with what's out there in the world, right? An argument is sound if its premises are actually true. Is it actually true that all humans have three heads? No. Is it actually true that Kobe is a human? Yes, in all likelihood, depending upon, right, there are a couple of remarks that I can make there, but I will leave it. And so this argument is valid, it's not sound, and remember the crucial distinction. None of these statements is valid. None of these statements is sound. The argument is valid, and the argument is not sound. That's an important distinction to keep in mind. So this argument is valid. This argument is not sound. Okay, next up. Premise one. Ernesto likes both Justin Bieber and Mariah Carey. Thus, Ernesto likes Justin Bieber. Yeah, okay. Is this argument valid and sound? Well, we know premise one says Ernesto likes both of these people. He likes Justin Bieber and he likes Mariah Carey. Okay, so if he likes them each on their own, then he likes the first one that he likes, Justin Bieber. All right, so this argument is valid. Now, is it sound? Well, we don't know. We don't know what Ernesto likes. Does Ernesto actually like them? I don't know. I don't know who Ernesto is. But to determine soundness, we would need to know who that is, right? Soundness asks whether the premise is actually true. Is the premise actually true? Now, there's a quick side note here, and I just want to make a quick distinction for you. Sometimes people say, like, you can imagine a case where somebody says something like, yeah, I like Justin Bieber and Mariah Carey, meaning I like the song that they sang together, that Christmas song. What? Okay. I like them both together, but I don't like them individually. And so it looks like one would be true and two would be false or something like that. Okay, we aren't talking about that case. If we were going to say that, we would need to say Ernesto likes the song that Justin Bieber and Mariah Carey sing together, or Ernesto likes Justin Bieber and Mariah Carey together only, or something like that. In other words, in logic, we are careful to fix the meaning of our terms so rigidly that we can then preserve the truth conditions and apply these rigid classifications of validity and soundness. So just keep that in mind. The argument is valid. Is it sound? We don't know because we don't know enough about Ernesto. Okay, and remember, you'll never have a case like that where it's unclear whether this argument is valid or, you know, you don't know whether the argument is sound because I haven't told you the meaning of the terms or to whom Ernesto refers. All right, another argument. Here we go. Premise one, all mammals have lungs. Premise two, iguanas have lungs. Conclusion three, iguanas are mammals. All right, think about this one for a minute. Is this argument valid? In other words, if it's true that all mammals have lungs, and if it's true that iguanas have lungs, does it necessarily follow that iguanas are mammals? Think about that for a moment. You can pause if you want. Okay, and then ask whether you think it's sound. And remember, whether or not an argument is sound depends on whether or not it's valid. And so if you have not found an argument to be valid, then you don't need to address whether or not the argument is sound, because you only talk about soundness if the argument is valid first, right? So it's VS, like versus, right? So if it's valid, then you can talk about soundness, but if you don't think the argument is valid, then don't go on to soundness, right? So you have to have the V before you have the S. That's the way to think about it. Okay, this argument is not valid. Now, it's a little bit tricky. If you caught it, big up, way to go. If you didn't catch it, don't worry about it. This one gets almost everybody, right? Got me, right? I was the C student in this. I was scraping by my fingernails, and I managed to get this stuff. So you will also be able to get it. It's just that it's unusual and it's unfamiliar to you. And so it's like riding a bike. You know, once you kind of get it, you'll get it. But it's difficult to get it first if it's not familiar. It doesn't have anything to do with intelligence. It's just familiarity of the concepts. Okay, remember, why is this argument not valid? Well, let's talk about validity again. Validity means if one and two are true, three has to be true. It's not possible for one and two to be true and three to be false. Those are our definitions of validity. Look, it can be true that all mammals have lungs. And it can be true that iguanas have lungs. But it does not follow from one and two that iguanas are mammals, because I have not said that only mammals have lungs. You see that? I said all mammals have lungs. I've left out other classes of objects that might also have lungs, but that are not mammals. And so that's why One and two can be true, but three can be false. Pretty sweet, huh? Okay, let's look at another example. By the way, just so you know, you don't need to worry about this. This type of argument, because it refers to classes of objects or categories of objects, this is called categorical logic, and it comes from Aristotle. It worked for a long time, and it was really neat until logicians in the late 19th century started to discover that there were problems with Aristotelian logic. And so they sort of re-upped logic and redeveloped a modern logic, which paved the way for the modern microprocessor. But we don't have time for that. Let's get into this next one. Okay, you won't be tested on that. Here we go. Premise number one. If it rains, then I carry my umbrella. Premise two. I am carrying my umbrella. Conclusion three. Thus it is raining. Okay, so ask yourself, first, is this argument valid? If you want to pause. If you don't, that's fine. Okay, if I'm asking whether or not an argument is valid, I'm asking if the truth of one and two guarantees the truth of three. In other words, if one is two and two is true, does it force three to be true? Could I imagine a case where one and two are true, but three is false, right? So let's work this one. All right, let's think about this. Premise one says, if it rains, I carry my umbrella. Premise two says I'm carrying my umbrella. And so conclusion is that it is raining. So couldn't it be true that it's true that if it rains, I carry my umbrella, and it's true that I'm carrying my umbrella, but it's false that it's raining? Of course. It could just be that I'm carrying my umbrella because it's hot. Notice the difference here. In a case where I'm just carrying my umbrella because it's hot, and oh my gosh, it would have been great if I had an umbrella here, right? That would have been awesome. Okay. Sorry. Stupid. Okay, I was thinking, how if I brought Kobe over, right, when I was doing the Kobe example? I don't know Kobe. Okay, here we go. Imagine I'm carrying an umbrella on a super hot day, right? In such a case, it would be true that I'm carrying my umbrella, so two would be true. And it would also be true that if it was raining, I would be carrying my umbrella. But it would be false that it's raining just because it's super hot. You see? So this argument is not valid because I can imagine a case where one is true and two is true, but three is not. Namely, the case where it's super duper hot, and so it's true that I'm carrying my umbrella. And it's also true that if it rains, I will also carry my umbrella. But it just so happens that it's not raining, it's just super hot, and that's why three could be false. So one is true, if one is true and two is true, it doesn't guarantee that three is true, and so the argument is not valid, right? Valid is a good thing. It's like you set up your ducks in a row and you force somebody, if you accept one and you accept two, validity, you want them to be forced into the conclusion, right? You want somebody to have to relent and acknowledge, yes, if premises are true, I have to accept your conclusion. In this argument, that doesn't happen because you could have a counterexample where I am carrying my umbrella, and it's also true that if it was raining, then I would be also carrying my umbrella, but it happens to be super hot, and so it's false that it's raining. All right, so this argument is not valid. And remember, we only talk about soundness if the argument is valid, but because this argument is not valid, we do not discuss soundness. So if it's not valid, you're done. You don't need to worry about soundness. But if it is valid, then you can go on and ask whether or not the premises are actually true and assess whether the argument is valid. Okay, let's rock and roll here on this next one. Premise one, all dogs are mammals. Premise two, all mammals have green fur. Conclusion, thus, all dogs have green fur. Okay, let's talk about this. First thing we're going to look at is validity. So, validity asks, if one and two are true, does three have to be true? So, premise one, all dogs are mammals. Premise two, all mammals have green fur. Okay, suppose it's true that all dogs are mammals. They are. But suppose it's true. Suppose it's also true that all mammals have green fur. Would it then follow that all dogs have green fur? Yes, it would. I'm not asking you at this point whether it is actually the case that all mammals have green fur. I'm asking you if it was true that all mammals have green fur, and if it was true that all dogs are mammals, would that make it true that all dogs have green fur? And the answer to that is yes. That is true. Yes, that is true. But is it actually true? Is it actually true that all mammals have green fur? No, all mammals do not have green fur. They do not. And so the argument is not sound. So remember, if it's valid, then we will talk about soundness. This argument is valid, and when we go to assess soundness, all we're asking is what is actually true. Is it actually true that all mammals have green fur? No, it's not. And so the argument is not sound. So this argument is valid, but it's not sound. Let's do this one here. Okay, back to the horror stuff. Premise one. Anyone who is rational gets scared by horror films. Professor Vitt gets scared by horror films. Thus, Professor Vitt is rational. Okay. So, ask yourself, is this argument valid? Meaning, if one is true and two is true, does three have to be true? So, if it's true that anyone who's rational gets scared by horror films, and if it's true that Professor Vitt gets scared by horror films, does that then guarantee that Professor Vitt is rational? Think about this one a minute. Okay, do you think it's valid? Okay, as it turns out, no. This argument is not valid. It's very similar to the iguanas example. Remember, I'm not saying only rational people get scared by horror films. I'm saying anyone who is rational gets scared about horror films. Professor Vitt gets scared by horror films. Thus, Professor Vitt is rational. In order to make this argument valid, I'd have to revise it and say something like, only rational people get scared by horror films. Professor Vitt gets scared by horror films, and so we know Professor Vitt is rational. But it might also be the case that irrational people get scared by horror films. And we can't rule that out, and so we cannot guarantee that the conclusion is true, right? So the argument is not valid, and because the argument is not valid, we do not go on to assess validity. We know the argument is not sound, because the definition of a sound argument is a valid argument with all true premises. This argument is not is not valid, and so it fails for soundness as well. And then this would be the revised version that would be valid, right? Only someone who's rational gets scared by horror films. Professor Vitt gets scared by horror films. Thus, Professor Vitt is rational. All right, that would be valid. And I don't know if it would be sound or not, right? Just don't worry about it. Okay, remember, valid and sound are super powerful tools. And I hope they are useful to you as you move through life. Just seeing the connections between what people think and the reasons that people give for what they think. All right, now we're going to move on to inductive reasoning. Inductive reasoning, we are going to concern ourselves with three things here: strong, weak, and cogent. We're going to kind of zip through this here. You'll need to know these definitions, but you will not be, we won't spend as much time on these. As you can probably tell by the timeline, I guess this is probably wrapping up pretty quickly, blissfully. Okay. An inductive argument is strong if the conclusion probably follows, meaning the premises support the conclusion, the premises make the conclusion more probable than not, right? A weak argument is one where the conclusion probably does not follow, meaning it's less than 50% likely, okay? So strong premises support the conclusion by 50%, weak argument premises provide 50% or less support. Now, the last thing we need to look at is cogency. An inductive argument is cogent if it is a strong argument that has all true premises. So cogent is almost like soundness, right? It's sort of the analog for inductive arguments. It's when you have a strong argument that has all true premises. And so an example of a cogent argument would be, every previous US president was older than 40. Therefore, probably the next U.S. president will be older than 40, right? You cannot have a weak argument that's cogent, just like you cannot have an invalid argument that is sound. Okay. Look, we don't spend a ton of time on cogency and weakness and strongness because, frankly, the percentage of support can be difficult to determine. I can ask students for the degree of support between premises and conclusions, and I can get some pretty subjective answers. Now, it doesn't mean that these aren't things that cannot be useful or applied meaningfully, but it does mean that it doesn't lend itself to being testable in a very straightforward sort of way. So I would know what a strong argument is, I would know what a weak argument is, and I would know what a cogent argument is, and I would know that those belong only to inductive reasoning. But I wouldn't be worried about whether or not Professor Vitt is going to ask you to diagnose the difference between us, you know, is this argument strong or weak? Well, I don't know, like we're down to 1%, right? You think it's 50%? I think it's 51%. How do you adjudicate something like that? Okay, that concludes the non-fallacy section for logic. I hope this was super helpful to you guys. I know it was a long haul. You did super well. If you have any questions, message me on Canvas, and I would be happy to answer them for you. All right, thanks so much, folks. Peace. I turn my head to the side. Focus wide and forget a time. I do not like it.